Good afternoon. So I would like, I have many people to thank, but I already did, but I would like to thank Mats Britberg with our great support in cartilage management in Aspetar, and we set up together the program of cartilage, and at this occasion he asked me to talk about this after the nice lecture that you had, you know, about the prevention, conservative treatment, surgery, to try to update about this specific topic, which is important for us, which is the cartilage repair and cartilage lesion and its relation with ACL reconstruction. So, in other words, where are we? Can we have some evidence? And yesterday I provide you a practical communication with video and so on. So today it will be a bit different, and I will invite you to a short, no worry, journey in the literature to see if there is some evidence, if there is any support on what we are doing every day and what we believe. What do we believe, in summary? And it could be the only presentation and the only slide of this presentation. Are cartilage lesions frequent in ACL tear? Yes. Is it bad for outcome? Yes. Are ACL reconstruction outcomes better than ACL reconstruction combined with cartilage lesion? Yes. Do we have to treat cartilage lesion in ACL reconstruction? Yes. Actually, it's not so obvious, and it's interesting to have a look on the literature to see what is true and what we can say, if we can say something. So the outline of this presentation will be epidemiology, in other words, how many cartilage lesions we have in ACL when we see an ACL tear. Is there any effect of cartilage injury on ACL reconstruction outcomes? What are the results? Do we know some results about the cartilage repair combined with ACL reconstruction? Is there any evidence? And then the conclusion, before the recommendation, which cartilage lesion must be repaired at the time of ACL reconstruction? In other words, do we have to reconstruct and to repair everything? And we try to find some recommendation. So what about the epidemiology? You had already a nice presentation about that. But I would like to focus on the fact that the cartilage lesions do not occur only in combination with ACL rupture, of course, you know that. And if we look at some literature, 36% in Flanagan study about athletes, of course, not general population, athletes can be observed, and 14% of these athletes were asymptomatic at the time of the diagnosis. So it's very important, because imagine you have an ACL tear. You don't know always if this cartilage lesion was before or happened during the ACL, so do you have to treat it or not? So is there any morbidity if you add an additional, if you put an additional procedure during the ACL reconstruction? This is the first question. Now, if we talk about the cartilage lesion and ACL, so combination of cartilage lesion and ACL tear, we know, we have some data about that, severe cartilage injuries combined with ACL tears occur between 16% and 46% in literature. If you compare with meniscal injuries, a bit lower rate, you know, for meniscal injury, 50% and 65%, you know that it's very frequent. So it's always interesting to compare both of them, knowing that both of them can be observed in the same time, and it makes an additional problem. In this registry study, 27% of the patients had at least one cartilage lesion at the time of the ACL reconstruction. So, you know, it's interesting to remind this percentage, 27%. And within this lesion, 20% were grade 1-2, so low grade, and 7% were grade 3-4 ICRS, so it means severe lesion. And the main localization was the medial femoral condyle. This other study, it's a busy text, but if you look at the chart, the table, in 67% it was grade 1 and 2, and in 33% it was severe, grade 3-4. And he found 20% of patients who had the ACL tear and the chondral injury in the same time. So if we try to roughly summarize, we can say in the literature, we can evaluate this, 20 to 30% of the case, we can observe in our practice cartilage injuries combined with ACL tear. So it's important, it's a high rate. But if we look at the grade, the majority of them are grade 1 and 2, so low grade, and only, if I can say, 30% are grade 3 and 4. So do we have to treat grade 1 and 2, grade 3 and 4, all of them. We will see that later on. What about the cartilage injury itself? We know that it can occur at the time of the initial trauma injury or after in the field of chronic ACL injury following different episode of instability, associated lesion, and so on. And this is very different, and it's important in our decision-making for the surgery. And it's clear that the literature report that there is an increase of cartilage lesion incidence in chronic case if comparison with acute. Shelbourne, for example, showed that 23% cartilage lesion in acute, and you go to 54% in chronic. Imagine, half of the case of the patient in chronic have cartilage. And this is exactly what we observe in our daily practice. So this is very important, but it means for a bit we have to treat this ACL rupture before it comes to 54%. And this other study, which is more complex, but we could talk about odds and probability, this study showed that there is 2.7 times more probability to have cartilage lesion if the injury was 2 or 5 years before the surgery in comparison with 1 year. And if you wait 5 years, it's 4.7 times, so 5 times more probability to have cartilage lesion. So definitely we have to look at that, and we know that, but it's proved and shown by the literature. And this other study is very interesting. You can find that in acute, it means 0 to 6 weeks, we can find 9% in this study. Subchronic, which is for some people, it can be subacute, but subchronic between 6 weeks and 2 months, 12 months. Well, I understand that 6 weeks and 12 months is very large, but it's giving us an idea. 26%, so we come back on the previous percentage that we already show you. And imagine that in chronic, we have 70%, 69.9%, so comparable to the study of the shoulder Shelbourne study. In addition, I can show you a different study. This one is interesting because it confirmed that there is a relation between the cartilage lesion and the timing between the injury and the surgery. But it shows as well, as we could show in the French study, that the older age and the increased BMI play a role as well, an increase in the percentage of cartilage lesion observed during ACL reconstruction. So if we summarize, we can say that to make the surgery indication, we have to think to take in consideration the timing between injury and ACL reconstruction. It's clear, there is evidence in the literature, and probably as well the BMI and the older age, which seems very bizarre because you will focus your attention on athletic population, but actually, if the patient is older and if you wait, the risk of cartilage lesion will be more important. So it's a decision which is very important to take. Now, the next question is there an effect of cartilage injuries on ACL reconstruction outcomes? It looks obvious, but if we look at the literature, yes, there are some evidence. The cartilage damage, the medial meniscectomy, then the lateral meniscectomy play a role definitely in the outcomes between 5 and 12, 15 years after the ACL reconstruction if there is a lesion, combined lesion. So you know this, we always find, by the way, cartilage meniscus, meniscus cartilages. We're always talking about these two structures which was very important for the outcome. This other study show that if there is a meniscectomy prior or during the ACL reconstruction, and or if there is a cartilage lesion observed at the time of the ACL surgery, the outcomes are worse, definitely. This one, again, the Kovalchuk showed that the Ikelisi score was correlated to chondral injuries observed at the time of low Ikelisi score was correlated to chondral injuries observed at the time of ACL reconstruction. And Cox and Al show the same thing, grade 3 and 4. So definitely, in the literature, this part of literature show that there is a bad effect of cartilage lesion in ACL reconstruction. But not always, and this is the problem. Some study, and not the least, have shown that apparently it should have no difference between ACL reconstruction with and without cartilage lesion. Probably is due to the grade of the lesion, so it's not so obvious. So there is a sort of absence of consensus. So it makes the thing difficult to define a clear algorithm to guide the surgeon to do the surgery or not in this case. However, I think if we look at the good sense and the literature about cartilage lesion as well, even isolated. We know that isolated grade 3, 4 cartilage knee injury can cause pain, effusion, and affect the return to sport alone. We know that. So it seems that it's appropriate to manage the high, at least the high-grade focal chondral defect simultaneously with ACL surgical treatment, and especially if there is a meniscus, combined meniscus lesion. So I think the message is quite clear. Now the next question is, what are the results of cartilage repair and ACL reconstruction? In other words, do we have some data? It's surprising that we don't have a lot of literature, and with Mats we were quite surprised when we discussed about the literature. We don't have really evidence in terms of, is there a comparison and a comparative study about ACL reconstruction with and without cartilage repair, is there any difference? So it means we have a chamber of improvement and work here. And even if this study showed no difference, you know, it was only 40 patients included in the study. So definitely we cannot give a strong answer, knowing in addition that there is clearly a potential of spontaneous healing process. We know that, you know, for like for the meniscus repair, you know, that we know that the meniscus repair at the same time than ACL reconstruction works better than the isolated meniscus repair. And the same, for the same reason, probably during ACL reconstruction, the bleeding, the intra-articular natural PRP and the progenitor cells make the spontaneous repair of the cartilage. And if we look at this study from Nakamura, which is very interesting, he did a second look arthroscopy after ACL reconstruction without any intervention to the articular cartilage, without anything. So just a second look. He showed that there is a significant recovery of chondral lesion with grading on both the medial and lateral femoral condyle. So whatever the lesion, it looks like it seems to improve spontaneously after ACL reconstruction if you don't touch the cartilage. So it doesn't mean that we don't have to touch the cartilage, but it's interesting to see this study. And it showed that there is not the same effect on the patellofemoral joints. So they conclude that there is probably a location-specific difference in the natural healing response of chondral injury. So in other words, if it is on the based on their study, if it is on the patellofemoral, maybe we have to do something. Maybe on the condyle, we should not do something. And probably we react differently because we prefer to do something on the condyle because it's on the weight-bearing area and not in the patellofemoral. So this is something interesting for reflection for the future. Then the next and last question, I would say, that which cartilage lesion must be repaired at the time of ACL reconstruction? So do we have enough evidence in the literature to have an answer? There is little evidence, again. Still, again, it's quite disappointing. But if you look at the study of Rotterud, which is very interesting, you show a difference in outcomes between absence of cartilage lesion or partial lesion and full thickness lesion. It suggests, with good sense, but no real evidence, again, that we should perform a cartilage repair in the same time than ACL reconstruction, especially in case of grade 3 and 4. And in addition, we should shorten the time when we decide the surgery. If there is a grade 3 and 4, definitely we should shorten the time between the injury and the ACL reconstruction if we can, must avoid the bad outcomes at the end. We must not forget the patient information, you know, that the patient, expectation of the patient, they talk about, they think about ACL reconstruction, they compare with their colleague in the same club. If there is a chondral injury, grade 3 and 4, inform your patient because, you know, 6 months or 8 months or 10 months after, he will come back to you and say, oh, okay, why it's not the same than my friend because I have swelling and pain and so on. So you have to inform the patient. I think it's very important to inform them that a cartilage lesion, I always do that with my patient, cartilage lesion was the most difficult thing to treat. We are better for ACL reconstruction than cartilage. And then the patient understands and he can have a true expectation than bad expectation and misunderstanding with your the surgeon. So if we summarize the message that we can get from the literature, I would say that it's clear that the presence of full thickness cartilage injury in conjunction with ACL tear leads to worse outcomes with ACL reconstruction. It seems obvious, but at least we can see that in literature. But currently, there is no evidence to support the treatment of partial cartilage lesion, grade 1 and 2, during an ACL reconstruction. This is very important because it means that we could have some morbidity, and sometimes we see aggressive treatment for a grade 2, not grade 1, grade 2, and we don't know what is the morbidity. As there is no evidence, I would recommend that the grade 1 and 2 should be respected, knowing in addition that there is a spontaneous healing possibility based on the work of Nakamura. So don't treat this one if you don't have which technique. I will refer to the presentation of Joao. We don't know. We don't know what is the best technique, and probably in the future, I think we can have more information. And the real conclusion I would say for this presentation is definitely, after the review of the literature, and I'm sure Mats will agree with that, more studies should be set up in the future to determine if there is an evidence and true recommendation whether type of cartilage lesion, depth, size, and localization should be treated, and which specific techniques should be performed. I think this is exactly the justification of this kind of meeting, where we gather a different expert, probably for further study in the future, to try to find some evidence in this very interesting and daily practice topic. Thank you very much.